matter what we were told, Impact Wrestling was not always the worst promotion in the world. In fact, in the early to mid-2000s, they were actually a really good promotion where wrestlers were working fewer dates than WWE and were making a good income. Some of their product from back in the day has had some of the best matches in the world. Feuds between the likes of AJ Styles, Samoa Joe, and Austin Aries made TNA one of the best, and at the time possibly one of the only alternative wrestling promotions to view other than WWE. Nowadays, despite having a bad name, Impact Wrestling is getting back into the fold of things and have some of the best wrestlers in the world on their roster, including people like Austin Aries, Eli Drake, Moose, Pentagon Jr., and even Joe Hendry. Their work has picked up a good deal. However, during a point between the mid-2000s and early 2016, Impact Wrestling, better known as TNA during that time, was a product which was not watched by too many people. The hardcore fanbase suffered as they watched decisions like bringing in Hulk Hogan and Eric Bischoff backfired spectacularly on the owner Dixie Carter. Soon enough, their financial problems were the gossip of the world as year after year people spoke about how that would be the year that the company had to close its doors for a final time. Thankfully for them, they were taken over and Dixie exited the business, although the partnership with Global Force Wrestling proved to be another nosedive for them. Now they are back to regular shows and seem to be doing better. In this video, we will list 10 wrestlers who were in Impact Wrestling but want the fans to forget that they ever worked there. The first person to be named on this list is Hall of Famer Mick Foley. He had to retire from in-ring competition 8 years ago, but decided that it did not matter and that he would compete in TNA. He had a full return and even won the TNA World title. When he won the title, he appeared to hate his time with the company, complaining about what happened there with the harsh language used in the Knockouts division as well as the lack of attendance. Eventually, these posed too much of a problem for him and he left the company. Jeff Hardy had an amazing run in TNA, truth be told, and if it were not for a few instances, he would have never been featured on the list. On the night of Victory Road in 2011, Jeff was challenging Sting for the TNA World title in a rematch that had been really built up. Unfortunately, before the match, Hardy did an overwhelming amount of drugs and was high out of his mind, in no shape to take part in the match. After an unscripted interruption by a furious then TNA producer Eric Bischoff, Sting pinned Hardy in less than a minute to make sure he would not hurt himself doing a move when he had no control over himself at the time. R-Truth, then known as Ron Killings, is the biggest missed opportunity in the history of TNA. R-Truth was far more successful in TNA than in WWE, but it was still a run that he will not want his fans to remember. When he was in TNA, he won the NWA World title and picked up Tag Team Gold as well. He was not treated properly there, despite winning the titles. The moment he lost the title, he was sent to the bottom of the card and disrespected again and again, not something R-Truth will want to remember. Booker T is a WWE Hall of Famer and rightfully so. There was little that he did not accomplish over his career in WCW as well as WWE, becoming a 5-time WCW World Heavyweight Champion, and has been one of the biggest faces in wrestling. He was included in the main event scene throughout his time with the company and proved his ability more than a few times. His run in TNA, therefore, is something that he hopes is forgotten by any fans who happen to remember. The reason he left WWE in the first place was due to the company's drug policy, and he used his time in TNA as a vacation to relax. He was treated as a star on TV and given championships, but there was trouble backstage. TNA regarded Booker T as a low-level star. They did not provide food or cars, leaving him with problems. Truth be told, he hated his run with the company. Seth Rollins is the Intercontinental Champion in WWE right now. Along with that, he is also one of the biggest stars in the WWE, with his star power being undeniable. Since his debut as a part of the Shield, Seth has not really had a bad run in the company. At points, his displays might not have been as strong as he desired, but at the same time, he was not disappointing either, as he made more than a comeback after his injury, joining the Shield until the faction had to break up once more. Since then, he puts on some of the best matches in WWE of all time. No one will deny that the wrestler has been legendary in his latest run with the company. Knowing this, it's therefore hilarious to think that his run in TNA lasted all of 27 seconds. He teamed with Jeff Watson to get squashed by the Latin American Exchange. Hernandez and Homicide defeated Seth Rollins and Jeff Watson in a mere 27 seconds, and that was it. No wonder that the current IC champ doesn't want fans to remember his run in TNA. Given that Road Dogg is currently hired by WWE as a producer, his run with TNA is something he hopes neither WWE nor the fans will remember. During his time there, he regularly badmouthed the company, who would become his future employers. He insulted Mr. McMahon and WWE continuously, with references which were easy to understand for the fans who wanted to. Since then, he has made amends with Triple H, but Mr. McMahon does not forgive easily, and will not take kindly if reminded of the situation. People may wonder why Mickie James is on this list. After all, she won the TNA Knockouts title on three different occasions. With all of that title victory and a large portion of her career spent there, there does not seem to be a reason for her to want her fans to forget her TNA run. Is there? No, there is. In one of the stupidest moments of TNA history, only comparable to WWE's Katie Vick angle or Mr. McMahon's fake death after the limousine explosion, James was written off a TNA storyline by being killed after James Storm pushed her in front of a moving train. Currently, James is safe and sound and very much alive back in WWE and teaming with Alexa Bliss, and has even competed for the women's title. She looks like she might spend the most of her remaining impressive career in WWE, where she will be safe from murderous storylines unless Braun Strowman goes on a rampage, that is. CM Punk's run in TNA was bizarre and disappointing, to say the least. He had already proved that he was capable of his in-ring talent with Ring of Honor, and at the time he was engaged in a blood feud there with Raven. So who did TNA decide to pair Punk up with during his 1 year with the company? Why, Raven, of course. Not only did this decision to pair him with Raven make no sense at the time, the fact that they were feuding in the other promotion only made things worse. The fans were just confused, and on top of that, they decided that the best push for him was in the lower mid-card and nowhere near the star quality matches he deserved. As a result, his run with them is best forgotten. He would later prove how badly TNA booked him during his run with WWE. If Shawn Michaels can be called Mr. WrestleMania, then Mr. TNA would be AJ Styles. During his 11-year tenure with the company, AJ went through incredible highs. By the third episode of the company, AJ was a tag team champion as well as the X Division champion. He would go on to win the TNA World Heavyweight title on five different occasions and was by far their biggest and best original star. Unfortunately for him, the company did not think the same, and even if they did, they did not show it enough. He was named in the PWI as the top wrestler, the only TNA wrestler to have ever had such an honor. The break from TNA started when he was made to lose the World Heavyweight title to Rob Van Dam, who was coming in from WWE. This was something that AJ did not agree with, having built up TNA all by himself for so long. He would stay for only 4 more years after losing the title before finally leaving in an extremely popular move by going to Japan. He finally joined WWE, and since then there has been no looking back, and he is the WWE champion and has been a large part of the company. Many wrestling fans, Ric Flair the Nature Boy is the best pro wrestler to have ever lived and competed inside a ring. Ric had a full career where he was the icon of wrestling in a time where there was no WWE like we know it now. He went from territory to territory wrestling and drawing huge crowds wherever he went. His insane popularity and drawing power is not something that can be overlooked at any point in time. Over the course of his career, there is very little that he did not achieve. Even in his later years, his run on WWE was inspiring to say the least. His dedication to the business was there for everyone to see, as even in his advanced age, he put his body through insane punishment, all this so he could entertain the fans who loved him so much. Unfortunately, everyone has something that they regret about their career. To Flair, there were several regrets about his once-in-a-generation career, but none were bigger than his run in TNA. He joined TNA for an enormous amount of money, and to wrestle with his friends who were there at the time, but his run was pitiful and an embarrassment. This coming from his legendary retirement match at WrestleMania against Shawn Michaels seems like an insult and a bigger blunder. His run was horrible there, and after the emotional masterclass against Shawn at WrestleMania 24, this made no sense whatsoever. And these are 10 wrestlers who want to forget their time with TNA. I hope you're all having an amazing day. Thank you so much for watching Wrestling Hub, and I'll see you later with more videos.